Hey everyone, it's Kelsey here and welcome back to my channel. Or welcome if you're new. Actually, everyone, welcome to my channel because it's been so long since I've been here, so I feel like I need to give everybody a first time welcome. So welcome to my channel. I am so sorry that I've been absent for so long, but I can explain. In fact, can I complain really quick? Like, can I have like 15 seconds to complain? Just 15 seconds and then I'll get right back into the video, I promise. I am so tired, I'm so exhausted, I'm so burnt out. I've worked every single day for the past month. Not even exaggerating, I haven't had a single day without a hair appointment. On top of that, I've had dance 5 nights a week, every week. Barely even been getting any sleep whatsoever. In all seriousness, guys, I've just been really, really busy. As usual, I don't complain about being busy because I love what I do. I love doing hair. I love dancing. But sometimes it gets to a point where I'm only human and I get tired. At the end of the day, the burnout is real. So I've had to put YouTube way, way far on the back burner. So I finally found some free time today. So I am putting together this YouTube video. So without any further ado, let's get into this video. So this video was requested to me by Lucky V, and she requested it like 2 months ago or longer than that. So sorry that it took so long, but better late than never, right? So this video is going to be my tips and advice for starting your own mobile hair business. So as usual, I have my list here with me, and I'm just going to hope that I don't talk too much throughout this video. So tip number one. First things first, make sure what you're doing is legal. Every state has their own rules and regulations when it comes to cosmetology, and many states have a lot of restrictions when it comes to doing hair services mobily. A lot of times it's because usually with chemical services especially, they want you to be in a salon, in a licensed area, make sure you have a certain amount of square feet per whatever. Like, there's a lot of specifics involved, so there's a lot of services that you cannot do at people's houses. I don't know about every state, but I know about my state, which is Pennsylvania, and most services you can't do outside of a salon unless you're doing it as an extension of a salon. An example of that would be if you were working on a bridal party and you worked at a salon and they want you to get them ready at their venue. You can go work at their place, but you're still going as a salon extension. You know what I mean? Like, you're not doing it as a freelance business. So being a freelance hairdresser has a lot of restrictions, so you want to make sure that you look into that before you start anything, because especially if you are a licensed cosmetologist, if you get caught breaking any rules, you can risk losing your license or getting it suspended if somebody catches you. Me personally, I work in a hair salon, but I have my own business on the side where I have my own personal clients. And my personal clients mostly just get braids and weaves and natural styling, stuff like that, and that's because you don't need a license in Pennsylvania to do those things. Because why would you? Because in cosmetology school, they don't even recognize our hair as a hair type, and they don't teach it, so why would they put that on state boards? That still gets on my nerves. Like, they don't teach this hair in school for some reason, just basic straight hair. Anyway, so that's what I do on the side. And just a quick side note, for those of you guys who've been following me for a while, you've probably seen me working at people's houses doing color services. Those people are my friends. I don't offer that as a part of my business. If I want to do color, I do it at the salon that I work at. But I do not offer that as a freelance business. That's just something I do for my friends. It's not a business transaction. You get what I'm saying? So yeah, basically just look into that stuff before you get yourself in trouble. First things first. Number two, and this to me is one of the most important things when it comes to running a business. Get your prices together. If this is something that you want to do, obviously you're doing it to make money, so you don't even want to get started until you already have a full, complete price list together. And honestly, I can go on and on about this, but I'm going to try and shorten this up as much as I can. So let me just tell you guys about the mistake that I used to make when I first started doing this. I used to have a couple services where I already knew what I should charge for them, but for most services, I never really sat and thought about it. And there'd be so many times when I'd be talking to somebody, you know, just unplanned, just out of the blue, whether it's like at a supermarket or something, and they'll be talking about a service that I know that I could provide, but I've never done it before, so I don't know what I should charge for it. So in my mind, I'll be thinking, please don't ask me how much it costs, please don't ask me right now, because what I would hope to do would be to go home and do some quick research and then get back to them and give them a price. But if they ask me on the spot, I can't be like, let me get back to you on a price, I need to give them something. And usually what ended up happening was they would ask me for the price, duh, because that's the first thing that everybody wants to know. and then I'll just make up something off the top of my head, and then I'll go home later and realize that I could have charged so much more for that service, but because I didn't have time to think about it, I couldn't do it. And one of the worst things that could happen, this is one of the worst feelings to me, is when you give somebody a price off the top of your head and then they respond by saying, "That's it." And then right then and there, you know, not only could you have charged more, but you actually had somebody who was willing to pay more. Because a lot of times you're going to find people who are just looking to get a cheap price, you know? So when someone actually was willing to pay more, that's a blessing that you just missed out on. So before you even start advertising yourself and promoting yourself as a hairdresser, sit down, take an hour, take a day, take a week, however long you need. Put a whole list together and get all your prices down and set with all the services that you want to offer. And keep that list with you, whether it's folded up in your pocket and you have it with you wherever you go. Save it on your phone. Put it on a post-it note by your computer. Put it somewhere, okay? Have your prices somewhere so that whenever somebody asks you for a price, you have a price already ready and you know you're getting the money that you deserve for it. When it comes to figuring out the prices that you should charge, there are a couple different ways that you can go about figuring that out. I can make a whole separate video on how I calculate the numbers that I used to get my prices, but basically you want to make sure that you are getting paid to cover the products that you use. If you are a traveling stylist, make sure that your traveling fees are covered, and then obviously you want to get a price for labor so that you're actually profiting. But I make a whole separate video if anybody's interested on how to go about doing that and making sure that you are not overcharging your clients and at the same time not undercharging yourself. You want to be fair. So the next tip on my list of tips is to be professional. And I'm saying that because as a traveling stylist, or even if you have like a setup in your house and people come to you, when you have that at-home atmosphere, it's very easy to get a little too comfortable with your work. Because if you're working in a salon, you would know, I need to be there at a certain time. I need to have all these products here. I need this, that, all that. You know, you make sure to be presentable, look presentable. But when you're at somebody's house or they're coming to your house, it's very easy to think that it's okay if you're working in pajamas. It's okay if you're running a little bit late. You know, it's okay if I have to run to the store because I ran out of gel. Like, that's not okay, okay? Don't ever lose sight of the fact that you are still a professional. You are still providing a business. This is still a service that somebody is paying for. So you want to follow the 3 P's, and I'm honestly not sure if I made this up or if I heard this somewhere, but the 3 P's of being professional is to be presentable, be punctual, and be prepared. So you always want to look like you are ready to work. Don't ever show up, you know, with your bonnet still on, you still have the crust in your eyes. Like, you don't want to look like, okay, I'm here, let's get this done. You want to look like you are ready to provide a great service. And you want to be punctual, always be on time, and being just on time is late. You want to be a little bit early, not too early, because I don't like showing up at people's houses like a half hour before they expect me, because I know me personally, if somebody does that, I'm still in my pajamas and I'm not ready for them to be there. So I don't want to just show up too early, but you don't want to be just on time because that ends up being late because you still need to get your stuff together, you know what I'm saying? So always be on time. And if you are running late, say so as soon as you possibly can. If you run into road construction and you know you're running late, pick up your phone but right away and be like, I might be late. Don't ever wait till like 5 minutes before you're supposed to be there and be like, oh, I should be there in a few minutes but I'm not. Like, tell them as soon as you possibly can if you know you are running late. And obviously if you are running late one day, you know it happens, but don't make a habit of it. Don't think that because it was okay last time that you were late, you can be late again. Don't ever do that, because if you were at an actual office job or any other type of job, you know that that wouldn't fly, right? So don't do that to your paying client. It's the same thing, same concept. Same thing, if they're coming to your house, make sure when they get there, you are dressed and ready to go, okay? Don't be like, oh, let me move this out of the chair. Let me clean this up really quick. Let me wash my dishes. No. If your client is supposed to be there at 10 o'clock and it's 10 o'clock and your client is there, you need to be ready to go. That's how it works. And of course, be prepared. If you are providing products or anything, make sure you have enough of whatever you need. So I'm using braiding as my main example because that's what I do. So if you need hair gel or jam or grease or oil or whatever, make sure you have enough. If you are the braider that provides hair, make sure you have enough hair. You know, you never want to be short on anything. That's just not okay, okay? And trust me, I've been in situations where I've forgotten things at home, and I hate when this happens because I'll have to run to the store on my way there, or I would hope that they have some gel left over. Like, I hate when that happens, but it has happened only once, I remember. And this is a client who lives like 45 minutes away, and I was like halfway there, I was like, how did I forget jam to do these braids? and it was a Sunday and it was late and everyone was closed and I couldn't find anywhere to get some and I had to ask them for some. They didn't mind because luckily they were already a regular, but could you imagine like having someone come to your house and be like, I'm here to do your braids, but do you have this and do you have that? That is not okay. Make yourself a checklist every single time if you have to, and like I like to pack myself the night before an appointment. Just make sure you are ready to go. Okay, you need everything with you. Your client should not have to provide anything. Unless you don't provide hair. Because I don't think there's anything wrong with not providing hair for a braiding service. I know a lot of people are weird about that. But me personally, I don't see the problem saying I don't provide hair as long as I don't charge them for hair. But that's a whole, I don't know, that's something really controversial for some reason. And I don't know why, but that's that. But yeah, all in all, just don't ever forget that you are still a professional. You are a business owner. You are running a service. You are providing a service that you are getting paid for. So make sure that you are worth the money people are spending on you. Okay, so I'm looking at the time of this video and I think I've been talking enough. So I'm going to end this half of the video right here. But I'm going to make a part two and continue my tips for starting your own mobile hair business. So I hope you guys have enjoyed this video so far. And stay tuned because my very next video would be part two. So I'll talk to you guys in my next video. Bye!